Hello, everyone. How are you doing? Welcome to Facts and Two Cents. This is Petal. Hope you are doing great. Welcome to my very late night recording. But my, oh my, I can't get enough of these photos. Of course, the last episode, we talked a lot about Harry and Meghan and their relationship with Michael Bublé and his wife, Lou. And oh, I love these photos. Of course, this is when they were at the curling and Harry and Michael had a great time curling. And of course, Meghan and Michael's wife is back there just hanging out, doing, you know, having girl talk while Harry and Michael try their hand at curling. But I just thought it was just so wonderful. And of course, I mean, they spent a couple of days together. They were there. They had the dinner, and then the second day they did this. I mean, they were just, I mean, it was wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. They did the curling, and of course at night they went off and did the gala event, where of course Michael Bublé did this wonderful rendition of My Way, as we talked about in the last episode. I posted the link to the lyrics in our community page. I read the lyrics last episode. Oh, so wonderful that he did that. I mean, I think I've watched that thing, the video, about, I don't know, maybe 75, 100 times now. I just absolutely love it. I love it. It was so hilarious, so well done, and so heartfelt. And it was just like, oh, how beautiful. And I can imagine Prince Harry getting a bit emotional about that, because as we've seen Harry, Harry is not one who, you know, like we saw him when they were singing Happy Birthday, it's uncomfortable for him. He doesn't like, he's not one that likes the attention in that way. And so he always looks so uncomfortable. Like, guys, don't. And so, I mean, we didn't see his face, only his back, but I could imagine it being emotional. It was just, you know, and again, it's the final evening for the 1 year to go, and then it's a whole year before he gets to hang out with them in that way again in Vancouver and Whistler. So it's just such a wonderful moment. And it was just, I mean, I love the lyrics. I love that Michael was able to rewrite it. I did it my way, to let it become about Invictus Games and about Prince Harry. And it was so wonderful, because the person who originally wrote at least the English portion of it, and I didn't realize until now that I Did It My Way was actually a French song, and Paul Anka, who rewrote it in English, and actually he was commissioned by Frank Sinatra to write a song, and he wrote that one in English. And so Michael Bublé teamed up with the writer, the original writer of the English version of it, Paul Anka, and they are the ones that teamed up together to rewrite it to make it about Invictus and Prince Harry. So Paul Anka posted about it on X today, and we were all responding to him like, thank you, it was wonderful. But this is what he said: two Canadians were proud to have a part in honoring Prince Harry and Meghan for their contribution to the incredible Invictus Games. I was happy to rewrite My Way for my dear friend Michael Bublé to perform for them. I'm like, oh. And of course, Paul Anka is an amazing singer and songwriter. He's been doing this for, I don't know, 50, 60, 70 years, something probably. And so for him to do that, it was just like, wow. I'm sure he's in a few Hall of Fames by now. And so, yeah, it's a big deal. And so I'm sure Harry was so touched. I know Meghan loved it. And I love how personal they made it. It's like Meghan calls him H and we call him Harry. And so I was like, oh, that is so cool. And not only that, thank you, Chris Baron Smith, because I wouldn't have known who this person is that Harry and Meghan talking to. But it says the Duke and Duchess of Sussex pictured with the Premier of British Columbia, David Eby. And I think the lady in the red is like an MP as well. So they are like dignitary and political figures there. And, you know, they are the ones that, you know, we know the British Columbia and Canada and stuff, they funded, they put up quite a few million dollars to fund the games. So they were all there. And I'm so happy Harry got a chance to spend time with them at the curling rink thing. So I was just like, oh, that's so awesome. So thank you, Chris Baron Smith, for that. I, you know, for letting us know. And also, too, a part of the closing ceremony, part of the closing gala was Prince Harry, after, you know, Michael Bublé even mentioned, one of our squaddies in our comments mentioned, like, Petal, you didn't mention that he said, like, Harry could come upstage and they could do some kind of Taylor Swift thing. And I was like, oh yeah, I guess I forgot that part. but after that, Harry, you know, gave a keynote speech about the games and about the 1 year or two. And this is Harry's speech, and I'm going to read it because I posted it in our community page, but I don't know if everyone is able to access the videos. And so for those of you who have seen it, you can close your ear for a minute. But for those of you who have not had a chance to, I'm going to read the speech. And so I'm going to just move our banner here so that I can get all the words. And if you have not subscribed to our channel, go ahead and subscribe and click the notification bell so you know when we drop a video, and like and share the video and join our 2 cents group, and I will bring the banner later on. So this is what Prince Harry had to say. This was his speech. Good evening, everyone, and welcome. Thank you all for being here tonight and for your commitment to making Invictus Games Vancouver Whistler 2025 possible. These games have been so warmly welcomed by our four host First Nations who have opened their arms and land to each of us. Not only tonight, but in the lead up to and during the games next year. From the bottom of my heart, I thank you. Your generosity is cherished. Our collective journey through truth reconciliation is an important one for all of us. And as we come here to learn, my hope is we can depart and return as friends. When I am with the Invictus community, surrounded by so many brave men and women who have served their countries with distinction, I feel humbled and at home. Your passion, commitment, and spirit have built a platform on which the British Columbia will develop our first ever winter hybrid games, including the first time sports sit skiing, sit snowboarding, curling, biathlon, and of course, skeleton. And as we look forward to next year's games, we are reminded of the progress we have made, the challenges we have overcome, and the victories we celebrated. Our journey has been marked by courage, determination, and an unwavering commitment to shared values of service, sacrifice, and community. This year will mark 10 years of the Invictus Games. The past decade have been a testament to the power of resilience and the unbreakable spirit you all exemplify. And boy, have we had fun on the way. From this trip, I am happy to report the air is thick with excitement. And the best part is, we're just getting started. The Invictus Games are not just a competition, they're a way of life, a celebration of the human spirit. The games provide a platform for us to showcase your abilities, to inspire the world, and to honor the sacrifice of those we have lost. It is a reminder that we are not defined by our injuries, but by our strength, our commitment, and our ability to overcome adversity. Invictus is not necessarily about winning medals, but about the bond that we built between nations, about the shared journey of recovery that competitors and their families are part of. Tonight, we take one big step on that journey, and in less than 365 days, we will welcome the world to join us again for another epic week. I ask each of you tonight to go out and share our message with the world. Tell your friends and family, your network, that on February 8, 2025, they should join us here or make sure they're tuning in and watching, sharing stories on social media and continuing to share the Invictus spirit long after the games are over. As we continue to prepare for next year, let us remember the words of William Ernest Henley, the poet whose work serves as the namesake for the Invictus Games. I am the master of my faith. I am the captain of my soul. Let us embrace these words and let us continue to inspire each other and the world with courage, with leadership, and with fortitude. Thank you, and I cannot wait to see you back here in Canada very soon. I am so inspired by this. I feel like I am an athlete as I'm reading this and I'm hearing his words, like hearing Harry. You know, again, if you've seen the video on our community page, you'll get it. But for those of you who can't access it, I just wanted to make sure you got his words. And so I am so looking forward to next year's games. I'm so looking forward to seeing it myself and being there myself. And now that it's right here in our backyard, very, very exciting. I know a lot of squaddies in the US and also Canada are going to be part of it. So very, very, very exciting. And what a successful time, man. So successful. These 1 year, two. And so, bring on the games, bring on the games. And thank you to the four First Nations who have welcome and really, you know, they're going to be welcoming the world onto their land. And I hope, as Harry said, when everyone leaves, that everyone is happy that they did. So, yeah. And I mean, it's just, I was like, oh, I can't wait. I mean, Invictus is so incredibly inspiring. So, yeah. Anyways, moving on from that inspiration to Shutter Island for a minute. You know, you're like, Harry's high. And then you're like, oh. And so this has been one of the things, you know, it's so funny. I'm like, the news outlet that I'm using right now is the royal family's, their go-to tabloid. This is their royal rota, part of their royal rota. And it's so funny because it's their royal rota that's been just sort of advertising William's supposed gaffe that happened at the BAFTAs, Sunday night at the BAFTAs in the UK. And it's really wild because as I'm going through all this, I see all of these clippings from the Daily Mail, their preferred tabloid, outing William in so many ways. And so one of the things that came out of the BAFTAs was this from the Daily Mail. I'm beginning to think that maybe William didn't pay his, invisible contract bill, because like, hello, you know, you would think by now, if he had paid up, that they would have taken this article down or something, but apparently it's still there. And so, William, you need to pay up that bill because you never know what else they're going to be saying about you. And we'll get to that in a minute. But this has been making the rounds. Awkward gaffe by Prince William as he tells actress who won BAFTA for harrowing coming-of-age films how to have sex, which ends with her being raped, making the movie look like fun, but admits he hasn't seen it yet. And there's so much in there, because then they posted that photo at the bottom and it's like, like, this is the moment when he said that, like, you know, again, they described the movie as, you know, in the end of it, she gets raped. And then his thing is like, well, luckily, you look like you had a lot of fun making it. And it's one of those like, I can't believe you just said that. And so the photo, when it looks like, for example, that's Ayo Debris and Phoebe Denver and Sophie Wilde and Mia McKenna-Bruce, as you can see the names at the bottom there, those are the young actresses. And they were up for they call it like the Rising Star Award at the BAFTA. And Mia McKenna-Bruce is the one on the far right, and she's the one that won it. And this is her movie. And so, you know, when he said that to her,
you look at this photo that the Daily Mail put there, it looked like that was that moment. It's like, I can't believe you just said that to a movie, that the ending with her being assaulted. That's what you're gonna say. That's what that feel, that photo evokes, of that big gaffe. And it's just like, I can't believe it. And so this is the thing that's been making the rounds the entire day. And William making gaffes is not, I mean, it's not a once in a lifetime thing. William makes gaffes, I swear, every time he opens his mouth, something ridiculous comes out and it becomes a big deal and it becomes a gaffe where he's mocked and just ridiculed and all. I mean, this is one of the just, you know, stay silent kind of thing with William. So it's not a shocking thing that he would say something stupid and say something as stupid as that. But the thing about it is, and I've said this on this podcast before, be very, very careful when you're using a photo, a still photograph, and basing a whole narrative around that photograph. I've talked about it with photographs or with Meghan and Harry and or other people. Be very careful when you're taking a still. Because the thing about it, as a photographer, I say this all the time, it takes a millisecond to take a photo, or if it's a video, you take a screenshot or an image from a video, you can do a whole lot of things with that video. You can make someone having a great time laughing and jumping around, and then the only time that they are jumping and screaming and just enjoying themselves, they close their eyes. And if you take that still and base whole narrative about that, it becomes something very, very different than if you see the video of them just jumping and dancing and enjoying themselves, and just that millisecond of a close, you can make a whole story around it. This is kind of what they did here. If you saw the video, I mean, if you didn't see the video and you just saw it and you read this headline, you would think that is exactly what's happening with this photo and with this headline. A whole narrative of William saying this really cringy thing. And then you saw the video and it's like, everybody look at him like, are you crazy? Are you stupid? How can you say that? Kind of cringe moment. But then when you see the video, it's completely different. The video, yes, that's a stupid comment to make, but as he admits, he hasn't seen the film, so most likely he has no idea what the film is about. So his thing is like, oh well, you must have had a lot of fun making it, is based out of ignorance because he didn't take the time to watch the film. We'll get to William and that in a second. But the thing, when you see the video, actually, I mean, there's a lot of things you can knock William for, including that stupid comment, but the comment and when you look at the video, the four actresses and they're relating to him, they look like they were having a great time. And even when he asked her, and he even said that to her, that it looked like they were having a great time, I think her comment to him about that was like, yeah, I think we had a great time doing it. Something like that, she said. She didn't take it, at least not from the video, she didn't take it as anything, you know, like a cringy moment or what this photo says at all. It actually, they had a great interaction and they were laughing and talking, and he was asking them about their training and all of, you know, I guess acting and all of that stuff. They actually looked like they were having a great time enjoying the conversation with him, and he had a great time and they were laughing and talking, and Aya was talking about, you know, just basically her appreciation for British theater or British films, and you know, the British in the entertainment community in the UK and stuff like that. So it did not what the headlines say and what the photographs said are two different things when you look at the video. And so again, I come back to, make sure when you see a photo that you don't base a whole narrative, no matter what the press says, you do not base a whole narrative of something around a still photo. Again, a photo is like a millisecond, that, and then if you just take that millisecond out of, you know, all the other times that they had, they probably had about a 5-minute conversation, If you saw the video of the 5 minutes conversation, it's a completely different thing. So that's all I'm saying, is that this doesn't quite match up with the photo, even though that's how it was sold today. Again, there's a lot of things to knock William for. This scenario isn't. But the idea that William could go to the BAFTA, he is the president of BAFTA, and then he has not watched the films, he has not watched, and we'll get to even more of that in a minute, that he has not taken the time to make sure, as the president of BAFTA, to make sure he saw those films, is shameful. It is utterly shameful. But we'll get to him and that in a second. But in terms of gaffes, William has done some stupid things. I mean, you know, again, that is, you know, even saying that, you know, again, out of ignorance, it comes across, but he did it out of ignorance. But William has had other gaffes, including this one. I think this was also done by the Daily Mail, told by the Daily Mail. The prince was at a reception to launch the 40th anniversary of the homeless charity Centrepoint when he was introduced to Jasmine Edwards. There's him talking to Jasmine Edwards there. Jasmine 80 from Sutton in Surrey had been attempting to explain to William 26 how the organization had helped her when she was living in a children's home, but was struggling to explain herself because of her stammer. Keen to help her relax, the prince leant towards her and laughed and said, "Don't worry about it. Just imagine me naked." It's just like, what? This is a 26-year-old man, and he's telling this to a very nervous 18-year-old who was stammering, trying to explain how the shelter of Centrepoint has helped her. And his solution is, trying to be ever helpful, his solution is, "Don't worry, imagine me standing in front of you naked." It's just like, that is just like, are you serious? And not only that, he has another gaffe from Prince William. Just like his grandfather, again from the Daily Mail, just like his grandfather, William makes a gaffe worthy of Prince Philip as he asks school children if they like Chinese food at the opening of a cultural center that celebrates Japan. I mean, it's just like, and you know what? And the reason I'm pointing these out, in a little later, we'll see why this is important and why stuff like this keeps happening. Because here is William at a Japanese cultural center celebrating Japan, and he's asking them if they like Chinese food, which means he didn't read the notes, he didn't read the briefs about what he was doing. He shows up and tries to wing it. And it's just like, are you serious? But yeah. And it's so funny that they mentioned Prince Philip, because Prince Philip is the king of these kind of gaffes. There's this site on, oh my goodness, I forgot to put, I think it was in the Independent, I forgot to put their logo there. But they have a list of 90 gaffes, as you can see the numbers there. And I just picked out a few of them, of Prince Philip's gaffes, about 90. Some of them racist, some of them sexist, some of them all over the map. Now, some of them just downright ignorant. But Prince Philip, is his whole life is marked by these gaffes. And I think Prince William has now taken up the mantle. It's like, you know, these are some of Prince Philip's gaffes. Deaf, if you're near there, no wonder you're deaf, he said to a group of deaf students standing near a Caribbean steel drum band in 2000. Yep. Another one, he says, if you stay here much longer, you're going to go home with slitty eyes. This is one he told to a 20-year-old British student, Simon Kirby, during a visit to China in 1986. Yep, call them slitty eyes. Another one, he says, we don't come here for our health. We can think of other ways to enjoy ourselves. He said this during a trip to Canada in 1976. Imagine going to somebody's country. It's like, we didn't come here for our health. You know, we can go other places to enjoy ourselves. Another one is quoted as saying, young people are the same as they always are. They are just as ignorant. At the 50th anniversary of the Duke of Edinburgh Award Scheme, the Duke of Edinburgh Award Scheme is for young people. And at this, and at the 50th anniversary of this award, he's calling those very young people ignorant. I mean, it's like, oh my God. And another one, he says, if you travel as much as we do, you appreciate the improvements in aircraft design and of less noise and more comfort, provided you don't travel in something called economy class. Ooh, which sounds ghastly. He said this to the Aircraft Research Association in 2002. It's like, oh my God. Oh my gosh, the cluelessness. Another one, finally, is, this one is like, oh my goodness. So who's on drugs here? He looks like he's on drugs. He said this to a 14-year-old member of a Bangladeshi youth club in 2002. I mean, over and over and over, this man, every time he opens his mouth, is something stupid, sexist, racist, and just like, oh, maybe you just want to stay silent. Well, I think William is totally following in his grandfather's footsteps, because it's like every time he opens his mouth, it's like, maybe you should just not speak. Maybe just, you know, have your aides say something. Or maybe just write it. Don't say, don't speak. And so it's just really funny with William and his gaffes. But again, one of the things that was very important from his interaction with those rising star actresses was the fact that he showed up at the award having not watched all the films. And again, he is the president of BAFTA. He should be leading the way. He is the one whose example they need to follow as the president of BAFTA. If the president of BAFTA, who is the British Academy of, you know, film, if you're not watching the films, how are you going to convince other people to watch it? How are you going to convince other people that the films that are made are important if you, the president, are not watching it? So Kate Manzi, who was at the Daily Mail, now is with the Times, she posted this. She says, Prince William apologized for his last minute decision to attend the ceremony. Remember we talked about this last week when I said William is going to be back on Monday? That because he saw what the reception Harry's getting, the great things Harry's doing in Canada, that William is going to jump out and Monday morning, William will be back at work. Well, he beat me by a day, like he said. He showed up on Sunday night for the BAFTAs. And again, which is exactly what we were saying, he decided at the last minute, and apparently if you believe a reporter from this morning, he said that William decided on Wednesday that he was going to go. Of course he did, because Prince Harry is in Vancouver doing amazing things with Invictus. Of course he did. And not only that, it says when asked if he was able to watch many of the 38 films being nominated, he said, I've done the fewest I've ever done before with my wife. It's been a bit. Hopefully we'll catch up. That says so much. He has done fewer than he's ever done before. That means he's never really watched all the films. As president of BAFTA, that's your one job. That's what you're required to do. And so now he is putting it off on what's going on, whatever it is the deal is with Kate. That's the reason he's watched the fewest he's ever watched before. William hasn't been really out doing much about anything. His kids are in school. You know, so when Kate was in the hospital and his kids were in school, what was William doing? It's 38 films. It's not like it's 100 and something. This is his job to do. And not only did he make a last minute decision to go because competing with Harry, he didn't even watch all the films. I wouldn't even be surprised if William has watched none of the films. I would not be surprised at all. And it's not even making a commitment that he's going to watch all of them. His response is, hopefully we'll catch up. Not even a commitment to be like, yeah, after this, I'm going to make sure I watch all of them. to be at least lead by example. Oh no, none of that. William, look at William. Why is he at the awards? To take photos with, you know, celebrities. Here he is with David Beckham, who is desperately, desperately seeking a knighthood. Here he is with on the right with Kate Blanchett, who of course is with the Earthshot mess. And that's what it's about for William. I go to these events and I take my photos with celebrities like he did with Tom Cruise and all of that stuff. It is not about doing the work. It is not about putting the time in and the effort in to make sure that you are prepared, to make sure that when you walk into the BAFTAs, you can have any conversation with any one of these actors, directors, producers, whatever, about their film because you have taken the time to watch it. Because again, that is your job. He couldn't even be bothered to do that. And if you think that's, you know, it's okay, maybe it's Kate, you know, can't knock him because he's taking care of his wife, whatever. He is, you know, normally better than that. If you think that's the case, you'd be wrong. Because in 2016, and thank you, what's her name? Evie Hatz, who posted it on X, who, and, you know, alerted us to this article on X. This is from the Daily Sun, and if you look at the date back there by my green arrow at the bottom, it's from 2016. This is when William and Kate were on a royal tour to India. They met, they had a big gala, and they met, the most of the Bollywood community there. And of course, you know, Bollywood was just rocking, man, doing amazing. And so they're in there meeting all of the Bollywood top actors and all of that stuff. And so one of the actresses that was there described what it was like meeting William and Kate. And this is her. She says, describing her meeting with Kate and William, actress Madhuri Dixit, or Dixit, I don't know how she says it, said, "We talked about Indian movies and how they were getting popular everywhere. The Duke," William said, "he hadn't watched any Bollywood movies, but he represents the British film industry and was interesting in collaboration." This is 2016. It's the same pattern, the same exact pattern of him not watching the movies, to show up at the BAFTA completely clueless, to make stupid comments about, oh, I hope, you know, I'm sure you had fun, but on a film where she ends up raped at the end. I mean, that's ignorance. He didn't take the time. And here it is. He is in India. He is representing BAFTA. He is, you know, representing the British film industry in a country where their export is Bollywood movies. And you're going to walk into that country and sit there in that gala and look at a Bollywood actress in the eye and tell her, oh, I have never watched a Bollywood movie, but I'd love to collaborate because I'm representing the British film industry. That is crazy. That is like this pattern of things. I mean, hello. And this is why William is such a mess. This is why they always want Harry. Because that's the one thing about Harry. He is prepared. He knows what is up. When, you know, I always remember Oprah talking about what it was like to produce The Me You Can't See with Harry, how Harry would be the first one there online because of, obviously, because of COVID, they were meeting online. He would be the first person in the meeting with all these stacks of notes and all of this stuff, totally prepared. Completely prepared. Another thing that another person who talked about Harry's preparedness was Travelers. I think it's the CEO of Travelers, who talked about, you know, they would have, you know, tell Harry something about something that they're doing, and they would have all of these notes and binder of all of these notes about whatever topic it is. And Harry would, the next time they meet, it would, there would be markings and questions and all kind of thing, because he would have read all of it. That's the kind of person Harry is. And then you come, and then this is who is supposedly gonna be taking the throne. Completely not prepared, completely could not even care The fact that, again, you go to a country where their major export is Bollywood movie and you're going to walk up in there and tell them, I've never watched a movie. I've never watched a Bollywood movie, but I'd love to collaborate. What are you going to collaborate about? You never watched a movie. How could you collaborate with people when you're ignorant of what they have to offer? What is there to collaborate about? It is incredible to me. This was William in 2016 and is the same pattern in 2024. And if you think that's bad, it's also in 2016, Ephraim Hathcastle, which is one of those, that name is, I think, one of those, anybody at their favorite newspaper. This is when they were writing, when they were challenging William and they were writing truthfully about what he was doing or not doing as an heir to the throne. And they were calling him out on his work shy and his lack of ethics or lack of work ethics. And so if this Ephraim Hathcastle article says that Prince William has upset officials by admitting that he hasn't read all the briefing papers prepared for his visit. And this is the thing. They gave him the information. They gave him the paperwork that would prepare him, and he didn't read it. Which is what I believe happened when they went to the Caribbean tour. When they were just completely clueless. From country to country, completely clueless. They didn't care to read the briefing notes that I'm sure their staff or whoever or the Foreign Office prepared for them, so that when they go, they can speak and they can speak intelligently to the people in those countries, showing that they respect them enough to know their culture, to know the things that, you know, the things that the government, their own government, needs highlighted when they go on the tour. William doesn't care enough to read it. And so this article back in 2016, this is what it says. William has upset officials by admitting he hasn't read all the briefing papers prepared for his visit. This leaves him unprepared, hello, to press home matters our government wants him to raise. It appears that William has picked up the trick from his father, the Prince of Wales. Imagine that. You are sending these people taxpayer money, sending these people on private jets to whatever country you're sending them for, and they couldn't even be bothered to read all the notes that you've given them to prepare them. So they go in there and they try to wing it and then fall on their faces. Charles tend to ignore briefing papers that don't interest them, i.e. most of them, often leaving him underprepared. When he took the Queen's place at a Commonwealth summit for the first time in Sri Lanka in 2013, some leaders were shocked at his ignorance on Commonwealth matters compared with his mother's encyclopedic memory. My source says, neither Charles nor William are as bad as Edward VIII. He rarely read briefing notes, which ended up covered in whiskey rings. This is like a pattern, I guess, with the whole family, it seems. Well, not with the whole family, at least with some of them. They just don't care. They do not care. And this is the thing that we've seen with William over and over and over and over. William has showed in no uncertain terms over and over and over that being king is not his top priority. He doesn't care. He doesn't have the drive. He doesn't have the leadership skills. He doesn't have the work ethics. He doesn't have anything in him that way, you know, to be someone that you would want to be a king or lead, you know, not that the royal family lead anyone, but at least who pretend to lead somebody. William has none of the qualities that would make him a king, other than he was born first. That is the only thing. And the sad part of this for them is that the one who actually has leadership skills, who actually would want to do this because he could see the potential of what the monarchy could bring to the world and the positivity, is the one that they're trying to destroy and the one that they kicked out of the monarchy. And then you have this lazy person who's has no interest in learning, no interest in being prepared for what, because why? He doesn't care. He literally does not care. I don't know how many ways can this guy show that he doesn't care. But in every single thing, even in something as to sit there as the president of BAFTA and tell a young actress in front of you that you have not watched her movie, it is so egregious. It is so incredibly egregious. But again, you know, when you think in terms of how the British and how much a lot of them, especially the royalists, have been attacking Meghan, attacking Harry, this is what they deserve. This is exactly the king they deserve. Because they had people who could have really, really been there and shined and get the monarchy into the next level. But instead, they chose this guy. And so they're going to have to live with, you know, lie on the bed that they made. Absolutely unbelievable. And if that's not enough, Republic staff who has been on their case says this is all William has done since the start of the year. The BAFTA Awards will be his fourth engagement and the third day of engagement since January 1st. Two brief investiture ceremony, one gala and one award ceremony. That's it. And for that, we give him more than £22 million a year. This is egregious. And it's right. But if you read this, it's two investiture, one like a Thanksgiving service, one the air ambulance gala, which is, you know, was the same day as the one of the investitures where he looked drunk. So basically 3 days, and then, you know, the BAFTAs where he didn't watch any film or know anything. That's all he's done. And so Graham Smith and Republic is all right. They're paying this guy $22 million a year to do basically nothing. So Republic on Commonwealth Day, which is March 11th, they're going to be out there with their Not My King side protesting. You know, it says breaking news, Republic will be protesting Commonwealth Day on the 11th of March. So if you're interested in going and protesting and being like, you know, not my king, now definitely get in touch with them and get your yellow sign. Unbelievable. I mean, look at this. This is all this man has done. Unreal. Anyways, so copycat. So the Sussexes are now using this as their logo thing at the top, their crest thing at the top. And of course, there was all this big hubbub about it. And then today, they're like, well, if they can have a crest, we can update our logo. The website, Government UK, has launched their new official crown logo for His Majesty the King. Picture, old one at the top and a new one at the bottom. So I don't know why they needed to change it, but it's like, oh, okay, maybe the top one looked more like a woman's crown and the bottom one looks like a guy crown. I don't know. But it's just kind of funny that that dropped today while they were all in a hubbub, at least the British press were all in a hubbub about Harry and Meghan using their crest thing. It's just like, okay, it's just so ridiculous. But it's like all of a sudden today, Charles has a new logo at the Government UK. Just very, very funny. And finally, we're going to end on a positive note after the Shutter Island nonsense. And back to Invictus Games. And I just love hearing stories about all the athletes and just what their experience has been throughout the Invictus Games. And CBC News chatted with this Ukrainian athlete, and this is what the article says. It says Serhiy Krapko, a Ukrainian soldier who lost his left arm and leg during the fight in Bukhmut in 2015, says that it's his responsibility to show what life after combat injuries can look like as fighting rages on in this country. As Prince Harry and Meghan Markle marked 1 year until the 2025 Invictus Games begin in British Columbia on Wednesday, Krapko was at Whistler Blackcomb flying down a run at the Winter's Resort in a sit ski, a single ski device for wheelchair users, as he trains to represent Ukraine at the Games next year. It's a feeling of freedom, he told CBC News in Ukrainian on Tuesday, speaking through his team manager and fellow ex-soldier Tara Kovalik, who acted as an interpreter. It is about being an example for those who are beginning to come back to restore their health. It's been almost 2 years since Russia invaded Ukraine in a significant escalation of the long-running Russo-Ukrainian war, which began in 2014. The number of casualties and injuries in both sides have been difficult to verify, but in August 2023, a report by the New York Times citing anonymous U.S. officials put the number of wounded Ukrainians as high as 120,000. My goodness. But here is, this Ukrainian athlete who's lost arm and a leg, and he is doing sit skiing and the others. It is amazing. This adaptive sport has given so many a new lease on life. And again, the Invictus Games stepped in, and where it's even more of a lease on life, they get to train for competition and really, really, really live. And it's just so amazing. And so I am so happy they all had a great time in Whistler, Vancouver. And I look forward to seeing them in 2025. It will be epic. So anyways, thank you, Serhiy Krapko and CBC News for that incredibly inspiring article. So that's it. Thank you guys so much for hanging out with me. Thank you to our awesome moderators, Lydia Church, Nelly, Karen M, Cookies and Cream, Black Queen. You are awesome. You're also amazing. I appreciate each and every one of you, Black Queen. I'm praying for your continued health. Cookies and Cream, you're also your son-in-law. I'm keeping them in my prayers. Thank you to our 2 Cents crew who support the channel on a monthly basis. You are absolutely amazing. Thank you also to all those of you who support the channel via PayPal, Cash App, also or during the chat via super chats or donations or all the ways you support. Thank you all so very much. I appreciate it in every single way. Anyways, that's it. I love you all. Have a fantastic day, and I'll chat with you later. Bye.